much? Do some of them charge more than is reasonable? And can anybody actually put a cap or make a decision on how much a professional fee should be in a free market? Now, these are some of the questions that are being raised after the Supreme Court, as part of an order, asked the central government to legislate around professional conduct and professional fees within the legal community. Arpan Chaturvedi has more details on what the Supreme Court has said.
Well, what this case basically relates to is a fee dispute between a lawyer and a client, and while the Supreme Court has given their specific judgment in that case, it has also passed some general observations on the need to regulate the profession and certain aspects of it. One of them, of course, being fees, and then the court also talks about other aspects such as strikes of the lawyers and such instances. The Supreme Court has cited its own previous judgments as well as some of the old Law Commission report, specifically the 131 report, the 131st report, which was submitted in the year 1988 by the Law Commission, and citing that, the apex court in this judgment says that though the report was submitted in the year 1988, no effective law appears to have been enacted to regularize the fees of the lawyers or for providing public sector services to utmost needy litigants without any fees or a substantially exorbitant fee. The Supreme Court again says that mandate for the bench and the bar is to provide speedy and inexpensive justice to the victims and to protect their right, and the legal system must continue to serve the victims of injustice. Specifically, in the end, the Supreme Court has said that it hopes that the government will come up with certain measures where it will regulate the aspects of the legal profession, whether it's on fee and as well on other aspects such as strikes as well. Now, it remains interesting to see what the views of the bar would be on this judgment.
Now, the Supreme Court in its order refers to the 131st report of the Law Commission dated 1988, which says that perhaps there should be a floor and a ceiling for professional fees. It is now understood that that is what it is asking the central government to legislate. But it does bring into focus the broader issue of professional fees that the big names, the big lawyers charge. To talk about this, I'm joined this evening by senior advocates Kamini, Jaiswal, Sanjay Hegde and Sattvik Verma. To get to know their views on the entire issue. Ms. Jaiswal, I'll begin with you. Is there a rationale for anybody to cap anybody's fees in a free market?
No, I agree. I don't think by legislation you can, if the client is ready to give and the lawyer is ready to take, you know, I don't see the government capping it. All that the government can do is come down more heavily on the huge cash transactions that take place. Why does government not do anything when it comes to the violation of, income tax laws by the lawyers? So, you know, those are the things they can do, but you can't regulate the fees. It has to come from within. Lawyers are supposed to be doing service. It is a noble profession. They're not supposed to be an industry, and they're not supposed to be mercenaries who are going to make money on the dead body of their clients. So, you know, it's unfortunate. And the other limb is that lawyers charge fees because they are encouraged by the way the judges treat certain lawyers. Certain lawyers get a better hearing, so they charge for their face value. You know, you'll be surprised that the clients will come and tell you, my matter is listed in so-and-so court, I want to brief so-and-so, it doesn't matter what money is charged. Because there is a certain, it's unfortunate today, but that is what we have come down to. That is what the whole system is all about. I'm not making that, saying that all judges are like that, but it's earlier it used to be very few. Now it is many more, and juniors just don't get heard. Juniors just don't get an opportunity to present their case, and the way they are shut down, shouted upon, and even at times humiliated, that it is, you know, and if a client is sitting there and he sees his lawyer being treated like that, the poor fellow, this is the final court. There's nothing between this court and God. So he's even ready to sell his soul and pay the fees.
We can hear you clearly, ma'am. Very strong views coming in there. And Sanjay Hegde, I'd like you to weigh in on the subject, because there is a brand value attached to certain names in the legal profession. There's no doubt about it. But then there is a brand value for a very successful doctor. There's a brand value for a very successful chartered accountant, or a very successful actor for that matter.
Exactly. And sometimes the person at the center of the brand finds raising fees one way of reducing work. Because just like Kamini said, that, you know, some faces are in demand. Then if there is a standardized fee, that face will be in such demand that the man would literally die of overwork. So often what happens is that senior advocates then raise their fees to have lesser matters. Despite that, there is a constant clamor, and the senior often uses pricing as a mechanism to curtail the number of matters that he appears in. A man has only so much time and energy. He decides he has to ration it. So I must also tell you that notwithstanding the very high fees that very senior advocates like Mr. Jaiswal and many others charge, there are also matters where they appear entirely pro bono. Very senior advocates, when I used to brief others, used to tell me that, look, I will either appear for my standard fee, which is X into the power of so-and-so, or I will appear entirely free. But to regulate fees in as much as it will be in a broad band between X into 10 or so, I don't think is quite the way to go about it. There is, it's not as if, it's a bit like saying that every actor in the film industry will be paid only a standard fee. Then almost all films, the producers would like Amitabh Bachchan or whoever else to star in this. It's not something that can necessarily be regulated by law, and most societies, especially in the West, have done away with this concept. The other problem with regulating fees per appearance is simply this, that then you are not looking at outcomes. The Supreme Court in this matter was concerned with an accident case where a lawyer, as is often the practice in the motor accident claims tribunal, the lawyers say that whatever we recover, a certain percentage is due to us as fees. Now, we have in the Indian law, Section 23 of the Indian Contract Act, which says that nobody can deal in litigation that would be campertious. The Indian law forbids such contracts. That is not the way things happen in the U.S., where you can work on a contingency fee. Because the theory is that the contingency fee allows the poorest of clients to have access to the best of lawyers if their claim is worth it.
You know, that's actually exactly the point. And I'm going to come to Satvik Verma to get a young legal professional's perspective on this. At the core of this argument, Satvik, is that all lay people, all Indians should have access to the law and to the judicial process. Even if they can't afford a huge fees, they should have an equal chance. And that brings in the question of, is there a morality associated with the profession? Kamini Jaiswal says it's a noble profession.
I think there's a couple of issues that you've raised, and I'd like to address them. As Sanjay pointed out, I think the court was dealing with a specific issue which dealt with a contingency fees being charged by the lawyer, and the fee that was paid resulted in the bouncing of a check, and against that observations of the Supreme Court in this particular judgment can perhaps be treated as obiter. And, you know, of course, the center will look at it. But in the last 30 years, we've not really had a law that's been promulgated. And that's for good and valid reason, because even after the 131st report, the Law Commission had another report. Also, the more important issue that the court has passed in this judgment is with regard to trying to instill greater ethics within the legal profession. And to that extent, the court has directed the BCI to relook at its own constitution. Now, is the law a noble profession? Absolutely, it is. We are professionals and we are providing service. But it's also important to bear in mind that this is a free marketplace, because at certain price, lawyers have the ability to say, you know, it requires too much time, I can't do it. You know, as pointed out, sometimes lawyers charge a higher fee to try and reduce their own work. And we also need to bear in mind that a lot of lawyers, thank you, I appreciate being called a junior lawyer. I am. I'm completing now 20 years at the bar.
I said you're young. Also have to, I didn't say you're junior, I said you're young.
Well, young also, thank you. Yeah, I feel good about that. But you know, a lot of lawyers also end up doing amicus briefs. And that's a pattern that's only grown in the last many years. And on amicus briefs, a lot of times lawyers get paid, and almost every incident that I know of, lawyers donate all of that money to the legal aid cell or to bar associations or for people that are needy. I think it's important to bear in mind that almost every lawyer at every stage of their profession does a lot of pro bono work. And now, you know.
Okay. I've lost Satvik's feed there, but I want to get Ms. Jaiswal's view in on this point. Key points which Satvik makes: we do pro bono work, we donate a part of our fees, and as Sanjay Hegde says, that sometimes fees are hiked to avoid too many clients.
Yeah, I would like to say, I can see it's not. Listen, how can you justify a fee of 30 lakhs for 30 seconds of appearance? How can you justify a fee of 1 crore per appearance? I mean, that only means that big corporates or politicians who have a lot of black money can engage you. That means a person, I'm sorry, let me finish.
Hold on, Satvik.
It is trying to defend an action by saying that they increase the fee only to reduce the work. These lawyers who are charging such heavy fees will have such a long list that half the matters they will not even enter appearance. They would have missed those matters. They will make a list of 20 matters. They may lease in 15, but 5 get, you know, people, they don't reach, and I don't know what is the consequence of those. The question is, you can charge your fees which is reasonable, but and also still limit your work. Nobody can force briefs on you. You can draw a line that I will not take more than so many briefs in a day. It doesn't mean that just because you charge so much, you take 20, you reach in 10, and then for the other 10 that you don't reach, you charge the 10 that you reached. You charge them double fee. Is there any morality in all this?
Okay.
To say that this is being done only to so that you have lesser, you can always curtail the number of briefs you take for a day. Nobody can force briefs on you.
Okay, I think Mr. Sanjay Hegde should respond to that, because he made that point that perhaps lawyers increase their fees because they don't want that much work. No one can force them to take work, Mr. Hegde.
Well, that's not exactly right. You take a matter on at a particular point of time for one hearing, because senior advocates necessarily are there for a hearing alone. But then the matter comes up again on another day and on another day. There are times when you just cannot regulate your work. Often in the profession is based on personal relations. You cannot say no to people who have been sending you work. So one of the ways is certainly that people do increase their fees. Of course, there is a reverse effect, which I've seen also, that in India often people confuse expenses with good. So the moment a lawyer jacks up his fees, people think, oh, he's worth so much, we better still get him at the higher price. This is one of those circular arguments which never get resolved. The real issue is, can you put a cap in terms of both a ceiling and a floor? Now, there will be some people for whom even the floor is not reachable. Now, even if a lawyer charges 100 rupees a day, it will probably not be, he will probably be not accessible to about 80% of the people in this country.
Yes.
So I do not think that you are going to get any favorable outcomes by putting a cap on lawyers' fees.
Okay.
Especially per hearing. What you're going to do is only to distort the market.
So then let's talk about what to do for those 80% of the people. And Satvik, if I could get a quick comment from you. Because that also is a crucial issue. Everyone has a right to access to the law.
Absolutely. Everyone has a right to access of the law. And lawyers equally have the right to determine what cases to do and at what fee. So we, you know, this argument of reasonable fee, who determines what is reasonable? Who determines what, you know, at the end of the day, please let's all bear in mind that a lawyer is, there is no metric or a formula by which the fees are determined. It is a function of A, what we see our peers doing, and B, you know, a actual reflection of our own ability and the hours that one puts in. Therefore, I think this argument that it is unreasonable, I don't think we should lose sight of what the, you know, actual debate is, which is about whether or not they can be. I think the most important issue in all of this is the profession has to self-regulate itself. No one can impose a regulation and say that Mr. Verma will only charge X amount of fee for Y kind of matter. And as was pointed out in this discussion earlier, you know, we don't put a cap on the fee saying this doctor is going to charge only this.
Yes. Because
there are multiple private hospitals. Why doesn't the same argument apply to the healthcare sector? That's, you know, the profession. And I'm not trying to pass the, you know, buck here by saying, you know, what's good for the goose is good for the gander. No, that's a bad argument. Make, but I do take shelter amongst the fact that there are different kind of doctors, and the medical profession is also
absolutely
a profession.
Absolutely,
the medical profession.
All right, I'm gonna leave it there.
How many of us go to medical?
Sure, I'm gonna leave it there. Only point I'll make is that government hospitals are available as an option to those who can't pay high fees in private hospitals. Is there such an availability for lawyers? Is there even an option? Is another question. You know, I'm sitting with three lawyers. It's a debate that can go on, but I will have to end it here. Satvik Verma, Kamini Jaiswal, and Sanjay Hegde, thank you so much for speaking to us on Primetime Debate. Very, very short break. Up next, we analyze the RBI's monetary policy decision. Ira Duggal has spoken with Shogata Bhattacharya, Tushar Arora, and Aditi Nair. Do join in for a slice of that conversation. Up next.
We have the veteran in our studio now, Shogata Bhattacharya, Chief
That's
Economist
right,
at Axis Bank, is with us. Shogata, welcome.
Right. Veteran meaning, I mean, planning retirement. I mean, yes.
Not at
yes.
all. Veteran of the economy and monetary policy.
Right.
So, you know, we all know it was kind of expected. There was small constituency which was saying that, you know, one rate cut may be possible this time around.
Right.
But tell me something. Is this what you would have done? Not what you expected the RBI to do, but what you would have done?
So I'm going to get killed. I'm telling you this. I'm going to get killed completely by the trader community, by my own traders. But probably, this is what I would have done. I think there's so much uncertainty in this current environment. Start from the global side. There's a huge amount of carry trade that was going on. I mean, all the portfolio flows that we had gone in. Now with the Fed likely to raise rates, certain to raise rates in December, with the three more additional rates, with the European Central Bank making noises about tapering their stuff. So I think there's too much at play in this current environment. Domestically, we have no idea about what the fiscal side is. The tax collections, we have to get some certainty on the tax collections. On the global side, again, commodities, oil prices are up. I mean, not likely to come down with all the geopolitics that is happening in the Middle East. Commodities prices going up, China beginning to structurally tighten their capacities. Growth, we don't really know. I mean, what are the impulses for growth going forward? How consumption is likely to play out? There are certain things that have definitely happened. I mean, the three major things that have happened since the last policy, the structural changes, the ease of doing business, the bank recapitalization, the Moody's ratings change. But given the kind of uncertainty that we are playing around at this moment, anything can go any which way. So at this point in time, particularly with the currency, potentially likely to be under some stress, I think it would have been very, very unwise at this point in time to play around with the differentials, interest differentials, with the potential interest differentials in the developed markets with what is happening in India.
But that's, I mean, they didn't cite that as the main reason. I know it was one risk on the inflation paragraph.
Absolutely.
But they seem very convinced that inflation, or they seem far more convinced that inflation is going to surprise to the upside than they are about growth. I mean, on growth, their comments were very tentative and very sort of indecisive.
Right. So, but I mean, I don't think, frankly, and I'm going to get killed second time with this. I don't
You're
think.
You're already killed once.
That's right. You can't kill a man twice. I mean, you know, except for the slow Chinese death. But other than that, a 25 basis point here, a 25, 50 basis point is not going to move the needle either in inflation or in growth. So that's not going to happen. What is happening, if it's seen the policy, throughout the policy, even more than inflation, it's fiscal,
yes.
fiscal throughout.
Yes.
So they cite their own internal studies themselves that inflation in India has become very level dependent on the fisc. So the worry is that state fisc not keeping up to whatever the targets are, slippages on the fisc, fiscal slippages is very occurring. I mean, if you were to use big data, that's the one that would show up, fiscal slippages. So I think that inflation is definitely, because that's the control variable that they are supposed to, that they're mandated to control. But the underlying drivers of the inflation, which is one very large part of that, is the fisc, I think is topmost on their minds.
Okay. On the fisc, and this is, you know, coming to all three of you, but Chikotu, I'll start with you. So, okay, so, you know, if you're comparing what is going to happen in terms of fiscal slippage now to what happened after the global financial crisis, I mean, they're very different sort of quality of fiscal slippage, right?
Sure.
I mean, we talk about quality of fiscal consolidation,
right.
But, you know, quality of fiscal slippage
Absolutely.
Here is very different. Should that not be important to take note of?
No, of course. I mean, we are not talking of the fisc going back to 6% or 5.5%. I mean, that's
or even in the manner in which the fisc is.
Or even, I mean, this is not a crisis. I mean, we are not facing a fiscal response to a crisis. We are not.
Yeah.
But that path down to 3.2% of the center's GDP, and forget the 6.2% or whatever of the consolidated fisc, that's been an incredibly difficult climb down. That trajectory, the glide path of that fisc down, has been a very, very difficult journey. And given the sort of fragilities that we see in India, the role of the fisc in stimulating investment demand in particular, given that private investment is still unlikely to come in the next couple of years, I think that's what is the key worry at this point. It's not the fisc slipping to even 3.5%, but the signs that if the fisc doesn't slip, your expenditure needs to be cut, and your expenditure particularly, I mean, given the commitments that you have on the revenue side, the expenditures that you need to cut back on the capital side, that's, I think, the cause for worry.
That's a cause for worry, and I'll come to that on the growth side. Tushar, you know, both of you are in Delhi. What is your sense? I'll start with you, Tushar. I mean, do you actually, you know, think that this year's number is sort of now, you know, it's a given that we'll miss this year's number? But then the question is, what could the next year's number be? What's your sense? I'm talking about the fisc here.
I think if you talk about the fiscal, meeting the fiscal deficit target and RBI's view on that, I think it's part of the bigger question of things which can be ignored at this stage. Things which can be ignored at this stage, one is the hike in HRA and you know, the impact coming on housing inflation in general. And that's a statistical blip, I think, which will now normalize after a year or so. Secondly, the fiscal deficit, whether that fiscal deficit is moving out of the range because of the rise in capex or because of the revenue expenditure. If it is going because of the capex, I think it could be ignored to some degree. Also, as you pointed out, it is not a very big drastic change in fiscal deficit. If it happens, it might be going up to 3.4 or max 3.5. That's not a drastic shift away from, you know, 3.5 we had last year. So these are things which can be ignored, and this is the main question which I think RBI should be asking, you know, and discussing among the MPC members. As far as reaching the deficit target for this year is concerned, we did a detailed analysis a month back, and the kind of slippage we were getting at that point of time was around 0.4% of the GDP. Now, things on disinvestments have, you know, picked up very well. So I think that number might come down to around 0.2, 0.3% of GDP. And that's the degree of cut in expenditure that I think a government will have to do to meet its fiscal deficit target. And essentially what we have seen in the last few years, that the last quarter, you know, government cuts down expenditure. And there are a lot of ministries which have still not spent money allocated to them. So I think meeting target is not a difficult task. I think they can do it with cut in expenditure and various other items. The thing is whether you know, they're propagating a right story or not, whether they're you know, doing this to meet growth, whether they're cutting expenditure on capex, or whether they're doing it on revenue. These are the details which I think bond markets look essentially, and also the ratings people look at it, you know, essentially.
Yeah, no, but I think the concern is wider than that. Aditi, you know, ICRA had done some interesting analysis on the states as well, because, you know, this is not just a center problem, it's a state and center problem. And I think if you put the two together, exactly the point that Shugata was making, that if you start to see capital expenditure come off both at the center and state levels, if you want to stick to that fist, then there's a, you know, sort of a compounding of problems on the growth side.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, let me just start with a couple of points on the center's fiscal balances. The concern this year is really on the revenue side. I'm not that concerned about the expenditure side. I don't expect there to be any overshooting. That's not going to be the reason for a fiscal slippage in FY18. It's really going to be whether tax and non-tax revenues are able to meet the budget estimate. Now, to my mind, as far as direct taxes are concerned, dividends are concerned, and the telecom revenues are concerned, for these three items, we are likely to see some slippage as compared to the budget estimates. Disinvestment, we may well overshoot the budget estimate, which will take off some of the slack from the previous three items. And as Shogato mentioned, on the indirect tax side, as far as GST revenues are concerned, there is a huge amount of uncertainty as to whether we are going to be able to meet the target or not. So the issue on the center is going to be whether the revenues are going to be at the budgeted level. Expenditure will be difficult to cut. RevEx can grow by about 7% in the remainder of the year on a YOY basis and meet the target. CapEx in any case has been front loaded and needs to be on a contraction of more than 10% to be within the budgeted levels. So I'm not sure if there's really going to be a lot of space to cut expenditure to be able to offset any slippage in revenue. So that's on the central government side. On the state government side, the uncertainties are far worse to my mind. The research that you were mentioning, we had put out some weeks back where we looked at the kind of increase in state development loan issuance in Q2, which was more than 40%. So the total gross debt being raised by the state governments in Q2 was more than 40% higher than what they had done in Q2 of last year, which was really quite an alarming figure, and possibly to a large extent did indicate that there were a lot of cash flow mismatches after GST had come in, with the IGST revenues not having yet been shared with the states in the form of FGST. Now, okay, coming ahead 2 months later, we've actually got a contraction of in SDL in October and November. So the uncertainties in that sense are really quite large.